Hello everyone, today I'll be discussing about a concept of humidification. The concept of humidification plays an important role when you design a cooling tower. And when it comes to a mechanical engineer, this plays an important role when there is a design of air conditioner. Now before getting into the humidification, let me discuss the basic terminologies and its definitions which will be coming across during the design of cooling tower. So I'll be first discussing about the temperatures, and let me get into the screen now. Let me consider an air water system. I'm generalizing it, and you can take any liquid vapor system. So the first temperature I'll be introducing is a dry bulb temperature. This dry bulb temperature is the true temperature of air without any touch of water. That is, let me take a thermometer which is kept in ambient air. So the thermometer, the temperature which is measured is my dry bulb temperature. A very simple temperature which will get it direct. Now coming to the second temperature, that is wet bulb temperature. Now before going into the exact definition of wet bulb temperature, I'll be discussing the concept behind the wet bulb temperature. So let me consider a liquid drop which is immersed in a continuously flowing air. This is my air, which is at temperature TG. That will be my dry bulb temperature. And here let me consider my liquid temperature will be greater than dew point of gas. Now what will happen, due to the temperature of liquid greater than the dew point, my vapor pressure of liquid will be greater than partial pressure of a water vapor. So due to this, what will happen? Evaporation. Now for this evaporation to happen, some heat to be given to the outer layer of water to get evaporated into air. To explain you very clearly, let me take each and every layer of this liquid drop. So it is my first layer, let it be my second, third and nth layer. Now here the outer layer is always have a tendency to move into the air by water vapor. So the latent heat to convert from water to water vapor will be coming from the water itself. That is, my second layer will give the heat to the first layer to vaporize, and my third layer will give it to second, similarly nth layer to n minus 1 layer. So in this manner my water will get evaporated, and due to this evaporation there will be cooling, because my second layer is giving to the first layer. That means there is a drop in temperature, that's why there is a cooling effect. Now combination of all this we call it as evaporative cooling. This is one of the very very important terminology. Due to the evaporation, parallelly there is a cooling of water also. Now this is called evaporative cooling. Now knowingly or unknowingly, you could have come across this evaporative cooling in your day-to-day life. For example, let me take a water pot made of mud. I think in every home in previous time we used to have a mud pot where we fill it with water to get the water in cool Now, did you anytime think that why there is a drop in temperature of water when you keep it in a mud pot? Because with this porous medium here for the mud pot, where the water layer will be spreading around this porous area, and the air which is flowing through the pot will get in contact with the water at the surface of the pot, which will get evaporated. And due to this evaporation, the latent heat which is required will be given by the sensible heat of water itself. And the heat which is given by the water to become vapor, this water vapor, there will be drop in my temperature. Because of which my water will get cooler. And the one more example I will tell you. Suppose when you enter into swimming pool, and once you come out of swimming pool, you suddenly have some shivering effect. And this is also because of evaporative cooling. Because when you come out of the swimming pool, suddenly you are in contact with the air which is flowing through the surface of your body. Due to which the water on the surface of your body will be vaporized due to evaporation, and my body temperature will reduce suddenly, because of which I feel shivering effect. Okay, these are the examples of evaporative cooling. Now, coming back, as I told, due to this evaporative cooling, there will be a drop in temperature which will be continuously, and it reaches one point where my liquid temperature will be less than a dry bulb temperature, that is the temperature of air. And what will happen when there is a drop, when the liquid temperature is less than the dry bulb temperature? There will be a heat transfer from air to water. This will continue and till steady state, my rate of evaporation will be equal to rate of heat transfer, and the temperature at this point is called wet bulb temperature. Now, my rate of evaporation will be m dot into lambda, that is the amount of water evaporated kg per second into latent heat of vaporization of water, will be equal to the rate of heat transfer from air to water, which will be equal to HAS into TD minus TW. I am taking the radiation effects negligible, then my convective heat transfer will be H into surface area into TD, that is my dry bulb temperature minus wet bulb temperature. Now, this amount of water evaporated will be equal to surface area into molar flux into molecular weight of water. From here, ASMA, the flux will be equal to the mass transfer coefficient kg into PV minus PA, that is the vapor pressure of water and the partial pressure of water vapor. Now, the absolute humidity y dash is equal to PA by P minus PA into MA by MB, that is my molecular weight of water and my molecular weight of air. Now, from this equation, PA into MA will be equal to y dash MB into P minus PA. Now, substituting this equation here, that is MA into PV, MA into P dash of A. If I write in those terms, PV into MA will be y dash of V min into MB into PV minus PA. Now, this vapor pressure and partial pressure are very less compared to this total pressure. Let me take this as constant of P average. Then substituting these three into my main equation, which will be equal to m dot is equal to As into kg, ma into pv will be my y dash of v minus y dash into mb into p average. Why? Because my p minus pv or p minus pa, I am taking it as p average, because these pv and pv are negligible compared to total pressure. Now let me take this as here, then kg, mb and p average is called ky, which is equal to kg, mb, p average. So now further deducing it, it will be as into ky y dash of v minus y dash. Now substituting this m dot in this equation, m dot will be as ky y dash v minus y dash is equal to, here it will be lambda h into as td minus tw. Now both sides surface area will get cancelled. Then my td minus tw will be equal to ky lambda by h into y dash of v minus y dash. So from this equation I will find my wet bulb temperature. Now here I will make few important terms. That will be TD minus TW is called wet bulb depression. And H by KY is called psychrometric ratio. In wet bulb temperature, my vapor pressure will decrease because of drop in temperature, and my partial pressure will increase due to evaporation. So this is the wet bulb temperature concept. Now the third temperature I will be introducing is the adiabatic saturation temperature. So let me consider a chamber which is well insulated to get the operation adiabatic. That means my Q will be zero. Here this water is taken into the chamber, which is continuously pumped into the chamber itself and sprayed, and air is entering into this chamber with the temperature TG and my absolute humidity Y dash. This air will get contact with the water in the chamber and will leave as air outlet with the temperature TS and humidity of Y dash S. As this water is continuously sprayed and which is getting into contact with air, it attains a thermal equilibrium and gets saturated before it gets out. So my relative humidity of the air which is coming out will be 100%. It will be completely saturated, and the temperature attained at this point will be my adiabatic saturation temperature. It is called as TS. Now as the water is getting evaporated into air, I'll be adding a makeup water here to compensate the evaporation losses, which will be TS. Ideally you won't be knowing the saturation temperature to add the makeup water. This is a limitation. Here it is a completely ideal case. Now from the concept I have explained, my enthalpy of inlet air will be equal to enthalpy of outlet air. Now the enthalpy of inlet will be y dash into lambda naught, that is the latent heat plus the sensible heat, which is equal to humid heat CH into TG, which is entering with the temperature, minus TR will be my reference, which is equal to the enthalpy of outlet air, that will be CH into TS, that will be my saturation temperature minus the reference temperature, plus y dash of S into lambda. As the enthalpy is the heat content of 1 kg of dry air plus heat content of water vapor along water. So from the definition we will get this. Now further modifying it, Tg minus Ts is equal to lambda by CH y dash of S minus y dash. This will be my adiabatic saturation temperature TS. This will be my dry bulb temperature. Now similarly, as I have derived for the wet bulb temperature, which is equal to Tg minus Tw is equal to lambda into Ky by H of y dash of V minus y dash. Now from psychometric data, for air water system, Hg by Ky is equal to CH. My psychometric ratio is CH for air water system. Now comparing this equation 1 and equation 2, my Tw, that is my wet bulb temperature, is equal to the saturation temperature for air water system. And it is not necessary that for other systems they should be equal for other systems. So this is the advantage of this air water system, where you can find the saturation temperature by knowing wet bulb temperature, because that both temperatures are equal, numerically equal, but theoretically both are different. And for other systems these temperatures will not be equal. This is very important point you need to note here when further discussing the cooling towers. Now coming to the fourth type of temperature, that is my dew point temperature. Now let me consider a air water system at constant pressure. I'll be reducing the temperature gradually. So as the temperature reduces gradually, the first droplet occurs is called my dew point. Let me take an example here, temperature, partial pressure and vapor pressure. As I told, the pressure is constant, let it be 2, 2, 2, 2 for different temperatures, 25, 10, 9. 8.5, 8. Let at 25 degrees my vapor pressure is 5. As the temperature is reduced gradually, it will reduce 5, 3, and at temperature 9 degrees it will be 2.1, and at particular point the vapor pressure will be equal to the partial pressure, so due to which what will happen, condensation starts, that is air can no longer hold the water vapor, So as I gradually decrease the temperature, here my partial pressure will also decrease along with the vapor pressure. So in this way, at this temperature, the condensation, that is my first droplet, is formed. So I will call the 8.5 as my dew point temperature. I think now you are clear with all four different types of temperatures we will use in the concept of humidification. My first temperature, that I discussed, dry bulb temperature, is the direct temperature of air measured by thermometer without any touch of water, will be my dry bulb temperature. And wet bulb temperature is defined as a steady state non-equilibrium temperature attained when small amount of water is contacted with air. As I told you, a small liquid drop is contacted with the fast moving air. And adiabatic saturation temperature is the steady state equilibrium temperature, that is my air leaving and the water in the chamber will be equal, that is equilibrium temperature is attained at steady state when large amount of water is contacted with entering air. And the final temperature that I have discussed is the dew point temperature, that is temperature at which first droplet occurs. It cannot hold water vapor any longer as it reaches saturation. This will be my dew point temperature. Now for the measurement of a dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature, we use a sling thermometer. Let me consider a plate which is hanged, and here we have a two thermometers. One which is completely free of water and the other thermometer is covered with a wet cloth of porous medium. So I will rotate this thermometer at a speed of 30 km per hour. In this way I can find my dry bulb temperature and wet bulb temperature. Now I am using this 30 km hour speed because in these high velocities the shape of thermometer bulb will be negligible. Now to find which temperature is higher out of all, let me take that relative humidity, you know, partial pressure by vapor pressure into 100. Now when you decrease the temperature, the vapor pressure will also decrease. That means from this equation my relative humidity will increase, that is the moisture content in air increases. This is the basic concept. So the dew point temperature, which is completely saturated, will be less compared to wet bulb and dry bulb temperature, and my dry bulb temperature will be greater than wet bulb temperature because of the evaporative cooling happening. So there will be some moisture content here, because of which my dry bulb temperature will be greater than wet bulb temperature, which both are greater than the dew point temperature. So this is the conclusion, where the adiabatic saturation temperature will be equal to wet bulb temperature for air water system.
If you like my video, subscribe to my channel to get more updates from my channel.